So in this session, we'll look at what is brownfield integration, and I'll give a brief introduction to what is WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, and how we can address the challenges in brownfield integration with WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. So what is brownfield? So these two images we have taken from some online resources. On the right-hand side, we have the greenfield, and here on the left-hand side, we have the brownfield. So the definition of brownfield changes from country to country, but in urban planning, brownfield is defined as previously used land for industrial or agricultural purposes. So when it comes to software, what brownfield means is that there are a set of existing systems in the enterprise already. So in the greenfield, it is a new system that is coming up. So why we need brownfield integration and why it is important? So if you take the existing systems of an enterprise, there could be systems that provide APIs based on standard protocols which we can use to integrate with other systems. But then there will be some legacy systems that does not provide standard APIs or support for protocols. So when implementing a new integration projects, we need to make use of all these systems and come up with projects to drive these digital transformation initiatives. So we can't discard the old systems, even though there could be initiatives to replace them eventually. We will still have to make use of all the existing systems. And then we need to cut down the time it takes to implement a digital transformation project. So in order to do that, we need to make use of the existing systems. And also, by reusing the existing systems within our integrations, we can cut down the cost and make the full use of it. And then there are systems that are not easy to replace. For example, most of the organizations have some legacy systems that have been there for a long time, and that contains a lot of the business functionality for that organization. So those systems are not easy to replace. But we need to make use of those systems within our integration implementations. So what are the types of systems that we encounter in a brownfield? So the, like I talked earlier, there are systems that are based on standard protocols. So standard protocols like HTTP, HTTPS, FTP, etc. So those systems which provide APIs for integration, so those systems are, so integrating those systems are not that complicated. And then there are systems that are based on non-standard or proprietary protocols. So these systems usually provide some kind of an extension point or a mechanism which we can use to integrate. For example, some of these systems will provide a SDK using which we can implement a client to connect to that system. For example, the SAP systems provide a SDK using which we can integrate with it. And then there are a lot of systems that are file-based systems. These systems usually output a file by processing, which is the mechanism for integrating with other systems. And then there are some systems that does not provide any kind of integration point. So for those systems, if they are stateful and if they are using a database system, we can use the database as the integration point for our project. So what are the key functional requirements that we need in order to implement a brownfield integration project? So first one is the ability to perform transformations, and then routing, and ability to orchestrate services, protocol switching capabilities, and then parallel processing. These are some of the key functionality that we may need to implement a brownfield integration. So here is an example of a transformation. So here we have on the right side, we have the new system, and here we have the brownfield system. And then this new system, user of the new system, is sending us a message. But the brownfield system is expecting a different structure of a message. So with the new system, we need to perform a transformation so that we can send the expected message to the brownfield existing system. And then routing. So in here, the user is sending two kind of messages to our new system. And we need to route the message based on either header or a property to the matching system in the brownfield. So here we may look at the incoming message for a message header or a content of the message or some kind of a property, and then route the message to one of the existing systems. And then orchestration. Here we may need to talk to these systems and then construct a new service out of the existing systems to reply back to the client. So the client is sending a message and we are performing orchestration of the existing systems to provide a composed service. And then we have the protocol switching requirement as well. In this example, we have this client sending a message based on HTTP protocol. And then we have the existing system, which is based on JMS. So here, within the new system, we need to transform or switch from the incoming HTTP protocol to the JMS in order to talk to the brownfield system. And then similarly, we need to do some parallel processing sometimes. That is to improve the latency of the system. Here in this example, the user is sending a message to our new system, and we are cloning the message and send it to these existing systems for parallel processing. So those are some of the requirements that we need in a brownfield integration project. So let's look at what is the functionality that is provided by the WSO2 Enterprise Integrator in order to implement these requirements. So before 2017, this is the integration architecture that we had. So at the center, we had the enterprise service bus product, and also we had the message broker product for messaging, and then we had the data services product for data integration, and then we had the business process server product for stateful long-running integrations. So then what we realize is that whenever a customer is implementing an integration project, they need more than one of these products to successfully complete their integration project. Therefore, what we did is we did a repackaging of all these products into a product called the Enterprise Integrator. So these are some of the functionality that is now provided by the Enterprise Integrator. So it provides data integration through the data services runtime that we have incorporated into the Enterprise Integrator. And then it has the Enterprise Service Bus functionality as the core of its functionality. So we have combined data integration and the Enterprise Service Bus capabilities into a profile called the Integrator Runtime. And then we have the business processes functionality supported in the business processes profile. And then we have the message brokering functionality supported in the message broker profile. And then we have a microservices implementation called the MSF for J, which is microservices for Java, as a microservices implementation runtime. And also we have the integration analytics and the tooling via the Eclipse platform. So these are the runtimes. So as I said earlier, we have combined the ESB and DSS runtimes into a single runtime called the Integrator. And also with the EI63 release and onwards, we are shipping a micro ESB profile as well. So the service integration is provided by the Integrator runtime. So that provides a lightweight, high-performance service bus based on the Apache Synapse project. And it provides a comprehensive REST, SOAP, and WSTAR implementation support. Additionally, it provides adapters like SAP and then support for FIX, HL7, etc. Domain-specific solutions are supported within the enterprise integrator. And then it's a product that is configuration-driven. So there, what we do is we develop an XML-based configuration using the tooling provided by the Eclipse platform. And also, it provides a lot of extension points. So any functionality that is not available within the integrator runtime, we can implement and add that functionality via the extensible extension points. And it has 100% coverage for all the enterprise integration patterns. So this is the data integration runtime that is part of the integrator runtime. As you can see, it supports relational databases, and it supports NoSQL databases, Google spreadsheets, Excel sheets, etc. So all of these services, data sources can be exposed as either a SOAP or a REST service using this data services runtime. And then we have the business processes runtime, which provides support for implementing stateful long-running processes or workflows. So the, this runtime provides capabilities to implement workflows using either BPMN or Beeple or WS Human Tasks. And also, it has the graphical process and modeling tooling support via Eclipse platform. And then let's take a look at what is micro ESB. So in the microservices architecture, there are atomic services, and then there are composite services. So atomic services implement some kind of a single functionality. And the composite services are implemented by combining the functionality provided by these atomic services and performing an integration on top of these atomic services to expose a composite service. So now we wanted to support this composite service implementation capability via our integrator runtime. So our integrator runtime has all the capabilities to implement these composite services. But it has a disadvantage because it has a long boot up time. So therefore, what we did was we reduced some of the components in the integrator runtime, which are not essential, and then came up with this micro ESB runtime. So it has a drastically reduced startup time. And also, we have reduced the distribution size and while keeping all the essential functionality within that runtime. And also, we removed some of the features that are not useful to implement MSA. And it is a container-friendly runtime. So if we look at the functionality, here we are comparing the ESB runtime versus micro ESB runtime. So earlier, the integrator runtime is having a 40-second startup time, whereas the micro ESB, we have reduced to 5 seconds. And the distribution size also reduced from 600 MB to 220 MB. And we are still working on reduce this startup time and the size of the packaging as well. So the service mediation capabilities, data integration features, and then tooling, the cart-based deployment model, all of that functionality is still available in the micro ESB runtime. So if you have developed any integrations using the existing ESB or the EI runtime, you can still deploy those applications straight away in the micro ESB runtime as well. But we have removed some of the functionality that is not essential, like the management console, deployment synchronization, multi-tenancy or deployment, etc., from the micro ESB runtime, because in a immutable container deployment, these functionalities are not essential. So let's look at how we can perform brownfield integration with the functionality provided by the integrator runtime. So like I mentioned earlier, So the, some of the key functionality requirements are transformation, routing, orchestration, protocol, switching, etc. So here we have placed a micro integrator, rather enterprise integrator, as the new system to implement the integration. So here, in order to perform transformations, the enterprise integrator provide a several set of mediators. So mediator is a key component that provides a functionality within the enterprise integrator runtime. So here we have a data mapper mediator, which allows us to do visual data mapping from one type of a message format to another type of a message format. So using the data mapper mediator, we can convert from XML, JSON, CSV to XML, JSON, CSV. And it can take the message or an schema as the input format and then transform based on the wiring that we will do on the data mapper mediator. And then we have the enrich mediator, which we can use to perform a simple message enrichment. And then we have the payload factory mediator, which we can use to construct a simple message and parameterize the elements within that message. And then we have the XSLT mediator, which we can use to perform some complex transformations. So here is a screenshot of the visual data mapping or the data mapper mediator. So here in the you have the input and the output. So for the input, we can import either a sample message or a schema. Similarly, we can import a sample message or a schema for the output. So we support JSON, XML, CSV, etc. for these transformations. And once we have imported the input message and the output message structures, then we can wire from one element from the input to the element, corresponding element in the output. And if we want to perform some kind of a transformation while going from input to the output, we can do that using these functions and conditional statements provided within the visual data mapping tool. And then we have this message routing requirement. Here we can use the enterprise integrator to perform message routing based on the content of the message, headers of the message, or a property of the message. Or we can do it based on environment. So in order to perform message routing, we have two mediators within the enterprise integrator. So the filter mediator provide if-then-else kind of functionality. So using that, we can evaluate a header or a content of the message and route the message to either system A or system B. Similarly, the switch case mediator is similar to the switch case construct that is available in a programming language, so we can branch out to multiple case statements using the switch case mediator. And then service orchestration. So here we have a mediator called call mediator, which we can use to sequentially invoke these systems. So here we have system A, system B, and system C. So using our within our ESB message flow, we can first invoke the system A using the call mediator, get the response, and then call the system B and get the response, and call the system C and get the response. And after that, we can combine the messages or the properties of the message to construct a response back to this user. And also, even though this call mediators, we will specify sequentially in our mediation flow, underlying it has this asynchronous non-blocking thread model. Therefore, the threads will not block for the response while this orchestration is happening. Therefore, we will have a higher performance while being able to implement this orchestration. And then we have the requirement to perform protocol switching. So here, within the enterprise integrator, we have the ability to receive messages over any protocol using transport listeners. And then we can send or communicate to the external systems using transport senders. So we have a large number of protocol support within the enterprise integrator. And so let's look at different types of brownfield integration and how we can do those. So like I told earlier, there are like integrations with systems that talk in standard protocols, and then there are integrations with systems that talk in non-standard protocols, and then there are file-based systems, and then there are systems that we might have to use the database as the integration point. So integration with the standard systems that talk in standard protocols, it is quite easy and straightforward with using enterprise integrator. So the integrator has comprehensive support for a lot of the standard protocols like HTTP, JMS, AMQP, and so on. And then integration with systems that talk in non-standard protocols, we can use the enterprise integrator. And then here, what we are trying to do is we have an existing system that is implementing a FTP. And then here we have we are trying to expose that system on an HTTP API. So within the enterprise integrator, we can perform the protocol switching and expose this existing system over HTTP API. And then integration with systems that talk in non-standard or proprietary protocols, there we might have to implement some of the functionality using some of the extension points provided by the integrator. For example, we support well-known proprietary protocols by providing adapters. For example, we have a SAP adapter for within the integrator to connect to SAP system. So here we have a system that is supporting non-standard protocol. So how can we integrate with that system? So here one standard way of doing that is to implement a connector or use an existing connector provided by the WSO2. So if the connector is already available for this non-standard protocol, the integration is quite straightforward. We just need to install this connector into the integrator runtime, and then we can support this integration. But in case the connector was not available, we will have to implement that connector. So within the enterprise integrator, we have a large number of extension points which we can use to perform these additional functions. So these are some of the extension points that are available within the enterprise integrator. So using these script mediators or the custom class mediators, we can add functionality that is not already supported by the mediators. And then we have like custom XPath functions, synapse handlers, access to handlers, message formatters and builders. And like there are like many extension points which we can use to implement functionality to connect with any of the systems. So practically, we can integrate with any system out there. But here I will specifically talk about connectors. So connector is a component that allows us to use third-party systems, functionality, and data within our ESB message flow. So we have implemented around 150 ready-made connectors that are available for download within WSO2 store. So these connectors provide the ability to connect to standard web APIs like Twitter, Salesforce, Jira, etc. And also some of the connectors provide functionality to connect to on-premise systems. And in case the available connectors does not provide the functionality that is needed to connect to the one of the existing systems, then we can implement a connector using the SDK provided by the system, or if there is a web API, we can use that to implement a connector. And then let's look at some of the use cases with the file-based systems. Because if you take any enterprise, there's always a file-based integration within an enterprise. So WSO2 Enterprise Integrator supports a wide range of file transporting protocols, such as FTP, SFTP, FTPS, and SMB, and so on. So here we are looking at a file handling use case where we have a legacy system which is either outputting a file or reading a file. And then we want to expose this existing system to via a web invocation API. So here we have two use cases. One is polling for an existing file system location, pick up a file, and then process that file and invoke that web API over HTTP protocol. So in order to do that, we can use the file inbound endpoint or the VFS transport available within the enterprise integrator. And then we have another scenario where this user is sending a HTTP request to our integrator, and then we want to go and look at a file system location, and then either write data to that location or read from that location and send it back to the client. For this kind of a scenario, we can use the file connector or the VFS transport sender available within the enterprise integrator. And then finally, we come to the scenario where there's no extension points, and hence we want to integrate via the data store that is used by the legacy system. So in this scenario, we can use the data integration capability provided by the integrator runtime to construct REST services or SOAP services based on the data on the data store. And then we can use any of the protocols to consume that data and integrate with other systems. So here, as a conclusion, we discussed some of the challenges that we might face in brownfield integration, and what are the functionality that is provided by the WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, and how we can implement these different kind of use cases using the Enterprise Integrator. So if you have any questions, I can take them. Yeah. Yes?
Hello, thank you for the presentation. My question is, I thought the Enterprise Integrator was the solution for everything, and today I come out with the Ballerina, with the Ballerina solution.
Yes.
In the part of orchestration, what is the trend to go towards a solution for microservices with Ballerina, or is it valid the orchestration solution that with BPMN and such?
So that is based on the architecture that you would want to implement on your enterprise. So the idea of the enterprise integrator is to support all kinds of architectures that you might want to have in your enterprise. So that means we support the layered architecture or the segmented architecture or the cell-based architecture. So in that model, the Ballerina is going to be a profile within the enterprise integrator in future. So any of the architecture styles that you want to implement, we support that architecture style within our enterprise integrator. And then the finally, the objective is to move the enterprises from this layered architecture to the cell-based architecture in an integration journey. Yeah.
Synapse runtime.
So the micro ESB is based on the Synapse runtime. So basically, we have taken out some of the components that were slowing down the startup time, etc. So it is actually the ESB runtime with a reduced set of components. So you can, if you have developed an existing integration with the EI, then you can directly deploy that car file into the micro ESB as well. Okay, then thank you.